Ladies and gentlemen, if you could grab your coffee, settle in. Want to make sure that we give as much time as we possibly can.
Just tap it with your finger. Yep.
Allow you to ask your questions, have your questions answered. So those of you that are arriving now. Oh my God, everybody actually got quiet. I sound muffled. You can't make out my words. So why are you shaking your head no? I won't be speaking for very long. In fact, it should comfort most of you to know that I will be leaving shortly. And the reason really is for you to have an opportunity to share your views. I have asked, as you all know, our friend and colleague, Anna Pond, to facilitate this meeting, and she will be taking over in a moment. But I just wanted to highlight a few things. Number one, for those of you that are not aware, is that gentleman in the back of the room in front of the camera is recording this session, as we are recording all sessions, so that we could have them available online for those people that could not attend. For your own review, if there's something that you found particularly stimulating or exciting that you want to review. But more importantly, so that we could have a record of your ideas, your suggestions, and not worry about, you know, transcriptions moving forward. Now, recognizing, and I am one of those people, by the way, that being recorded can sometimes make you a little uncomfortable and perhaps unwilling to say certain things or to share insights. At the conclusion of this session, we will be turning off the camera so that those of you that do not want to share something on camera but do feel compelled to give an insight, suggestion, or idea can do so off camera. All right? So we're going to try to achieve the best of both worlds, having an accurate, complete record, as well as an opportunity for as open a discussion as we possibly can. Now, since I said I would be brief and I'm already going on longer than I thought, what I would like to do is to impress upon you the importance of not only of this process, the fact that we are having a series of forums that will allow first each major constituency to share their thoughts, but also an opportunity for all of us to come together in the final session who were not able to attend another session to give their insights in terms of the strategic planning process is not simply a matter of keeping middle states happy or saying that we are able to have an open dialogue and open communication. We're trying to get information that will make this process as robust, powerful, and authentic as possible. There are two possible ways of doing planning. One is what we're going to try to do, as authentic a process as possible, reflecting the needs and the thinking of the college community, or to make it mechanical. Mechanical we can do. Authentic requires your participation. So I would encourage you to please don't be afraid of offending me or suggesting that something we have done in the past could have been done better or something that we're proposing to do in the future can't be improved upon. Share your thoughts and ideas. Be as candid as you are comfortable with. And if you feel that you want to share something online via email, do that as well. But first and foremost, share. With that, I will turn it over to Ms. Anna Pond. Did I miss anything, Anna?
Nope, you got it.
Ooh, she's got the whole little headpiece thing going on. Thank you.
Thank
I will
you.
Leave
Thank
now.
You, President. So I feel like I'm in a 1980s music video or something right now with this headset on. Feels kind of silly, but I'm hoping you can hear me. Can everybody hear me? That's the idea, so I don't have to shout, so we can have a nice, mellow conversation about this. So thank you for coming today. This is a great full crowd. I'm gonna move around so that I'm not because I feel like I'm in front of a huge group here, and so I'm going to walk around a little bit. But really, thank you for coming today. As the president said, the idea, when I sat down with him to talk about the process, he talked to me about wanting to have, as he said, a very authentic process. And I've done a lot of work now with other campuses, and I love processes that really engage the community. And so I feel like we're really trying to do that here. There will be forums with staff, faculty, and students. At this point, as I like to say, this is like when the ingredients are being assembled. We're doing forums to get your feedback. And then right before the cake gets in the oven, we're going to do another forum so that you can come back and see where we took all the ideas that came to us from the groups and where the strategic planning committee went with them and what they put together. So thank you for coming, and please come again when the next meetings happen, the next cycle of meetings happen in April. Okay? So the purpose of today, as it says here, is to get your input on priorities to support the completion agenda for the next 5 years. So, as you know, the president has talked a lot about completion being at the core of what the next plan will be about. And so, really, the conversation today is to get your ideas about what will move that completion agenda. So you can't see this, but it's on the website. And I'll give you some ideas about what it says. Basically, it talks about there's a 5-stage process we're working on here. Right now, we're identifying evidence-based high-level priorities. By evidence, we mean facilitating forums, because that's good qualitative evidence. You guys all bring a lot of expertise to the table from your years here and from your years in working with students. And so we want to hear from you. We're also going to look at other sources of data. I'm going to be doing some comparative analysis of other strategic plans that community colleges like yours in different cities in New York, as well as other places around the country, what they're doing around completion. We're going to look at that a little bit. We're going to look at some trends in education and kind of what's working and where. You know, articles have been written where there's evidence that certain strategies are working based on research. So we're going to be doing a lot of that. As part of this phase, the president kind of alluded to it, there's an online space. Dolly or Victor, what's the do we know the address for that space? Is it on the web? Is it a landing page on the OSTOS website, Victor? Okay, so it's on the president's office page. There is a place where there's an online space that's going to update you on what's happening on the strategic planning process. It's also updating you on the PRR, correct? Yes, Dolly and Victor say. So if you want to watch this video again, if you want to see what happened at the faculty forum, if you want to see what the students said, which a lot of you might be interested in seeing, all of that is going to be posted on the website. So we're also going to be convening a strategic planning committee. I'll show you who the membership is in a second. It's on a slide here. These presentations will be uploaded on the website, right, Dolly? There may be only one version because it's the same one for all three, but you'll see a copy of this. There's going to be a strategic planning committee that includes representation across all the divisions as we gather data to kind of be the group that kind of pulls together the theme to put together the components of the plan. So phase one is about collecting evidence. Phase two is also about taking that evidence and analyzing it a bit more with some more SWOT analysis and data mining. As I said, I mean, that's also what I just talked about looking at other college websites, doing some environmental scanning on education trends, et cetera. The third phase is to start to then say, okay, we learned a lot. What's the framework look like? What are the major components of what we're going to put together? And to start to construct a framework. I have a strong belief, hi, welcome. I have a strong belief that if you can't explain the bones of a strategic plan in one page, it's way too complicated, because you really should write a strategic plan that students understand, as well as community members understand, as well as faculty understand, staff. Everybody should be able to look at this thing and have the basics on it. So that's what we're going to put together as the strategic planning committee. We're going to come back to you where it says step four in vetting the framework, and we're going to have another series of forums where we're going to share with you what we put together in that kind of one pager and get your feedback. And then the plan will get written. And so the timeline for this is aggressive. The timeline is to complete the plan and have it ready by the fall. So this is this phase of early data gathering. There's going to be the vetting of the framework around April, and then the plan is going to get written May, June, July, August. So I also want to say that for those of you that are like, wow, that's really fast, there's also been this PRR process, the periodic review process that's been going on, which has been gathering a lot of data, right? Esther, right? Dolly, right? Those of you that have been part of that process. So there's been a lot of some original thinking analyzing what's worked related to completion as part of that plan, as part of that the periodic review. So we're going to have access to that data. The periodic review is due to Middle States, that's your accreditor, in June. So a draft of that plan is being prepared right now. So we're going to have access to that as the Strategic Planning Committee will have access to that. And that's going to go out to the college-wide community in the next couple months as well. So you can see that too. And you can bring that knowledge then to the April forums if there's something that you think is really important that comes out of that. All right? Any questions about process? That's the process. Okay. Here's the committee. I'm gonna go through it quickly. It's basically the PRR committee plus. It's really got, I think from the PRR process, we added a few more faculty members to the process and some other folks from key areas. I'm gonna go fast just because of time, okay? As I said, that will be posted. So I have a question before I ask this question. Hold on. I'll let you look at this for a second more. Who came to the PRR meeting that we had recently? Raise your hand. Who was there? I was there. Some of you. Okay. So a small a group of you. Okay. So because we talked about some of this stuff, so this is not so foreign. All right. So my first question is, raise your hand if you have ever been part of any strategic planning process ever. Okay. A good group. Okay, so what is strategic planning? Anyone want to weigh in? Help me out here, guys. There's coffee if we need it. What is strategic planning? Yes. Goes back to the. Yes, that makes a lot of sense. It's a way of kind of bringing us all together around a common goal, which is around our students. That's certainly what the completion agenda focus is. Any other areas? Carlos.
Where's the camera?
He wants to wear this. You know, he's dying to pull this off my head, right?
I'll talk to you, but you listen. It's when it's to set your goals.
Great. I think that's great. It's about large, high-level goals. It's about a pathway. It's about bringing folks together. Thank you. Yes?
It's also about making sure that we're all working together towards those same goals that we established and not working in different directions and in silos.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's about bringing folks together. So I'm just going to keep moving unless somebody has a burning thing that they want to add. So I'm not going to go through this, but this is Wikipedia's definition of it. And I mean, basically, as you can see, it's what your colleagues just said. It's about a process of defining a strategy, kind of bringing folks together. It also, the only thing I would add that is in the first paragraph is it does relate to the allocation of resources. And that's not just money. That's deployment of human beings in a process, right? So it has that. It definitely, as the second paragraph talks about, it's definitely many different definitions of it, but it is, as Carlos said, about goals and actions, and as others said, about kind of bringing everybody together around that to execute. It's a process. I think what I like about the next paragraph, it doesn't say the word outcomes, but I would add that to it, to Wikipedia's definition. I would challenge them to add the word outcomes, because it should, I think good ones say what will be different as a result. And even if you don't achieve all of those things, you know if you strive for an outcome and you say what the change is going to look like, you're better able to realize it. So that's the point of having outcomes. Because otherwise, it's hard to say, what do you mean by success if you don't put it in writing? So as the last paragraph says, it is based on data. I mean, you do analysis to come up with it. And you guys being here are part of that process. Okay, so I was told I'm going to click a few times. Hold on. Hello. There we go. Okay, it's also in a nonprofit or academic environment. Thank you for warning me about that, Victor, because I would have been like, what's happening? It's also based on an organization's mission. And this is a great example. I want to just remind us, of those of us that were in the self-study process, this is a great example of how change happens when people come and are part of a process. Because this visual and these 6 areas that came up, This was not what the mission looked like before the self-study. So those of you, do you remember how, those of you that were part of the self-study, we really had to figure out, and that was the accreditation process, that's the 10-year accreditation report that has to be written by the college. We were trying to figure out, like, how do we talk about the mission? And everybody was struggling with it. And it was actually a working group, not the steering committee, but a working group. So it didn't come from the steering committee. It came from one of the working groups that assembled that really challenged the steering committee to come up with a framework. And so that's where this came from. So it's just a really good example of how a participatory and engaged process leads to things that are better. So your strategic plan has to be related to this. And if you look at this, I mean, access to higher education is at the top of the circle, diversity and multiculturalism, English, math, skills development, intellectual growth, lifelong learning, socioeconomic mobility, community resources. Frankly, so much of this relates to completion and the way the president has articulated it. He has just put that at the center instead of, he has put that at the center as these are all the components related to it. So it's going to be based on mission. It's also going to be based on this idea of trying to achieve he has set a challenge outcome at the center to have a 50% completion rate by the end of the strategic plan. It's a 5-year strategic plan. And this is based on, there are a lot of reasons for this that we're going to go into in a second. But you can see from a data perspective, and I'm going to, Peter, where are you? Right there, right in front of me. This is the problem with getting to a certain age. You can't see close and you can't see far, and I'm at that place right now. So just scream at me, like yell, I'm there. So yes, I need bifocals. So I mean, if you look at it from a data perspective, we'll come back to this in a second as we talk about this. But why a 50% completion rate? So the steering committee assembled for the first time right before the holidays, and we talked about why a 50% completion rate. And we started with actually what it is not. And there are 4 things that you see here. It's not about reducing the quality of programs. So it's not about like churning kids through and trying to achieve it without having quality programs. It's not what it's about. It's not meant to be at the expense of excellence in serving students. It's not about holding it against people if we don't achieve it. As it says, it's not going to be held against people who are doing their best. It's not about, someone came up to me after the last forum and said, but if we set this, what if we don't achieve it? And I said, well, what are you worried about? And they said, well, will that affect accreditation? and it won't. So it's not going to hurt OSTOS's ability to exist if you don't achieve the 50% completion rate. And what it is it is, as we talked about, it's aspirational, that it is something we can accomplish. It is based on an analysis of completion trends. I'm going to pause in a second for Peter to weigh in on that, and I'll go back to that other diagram if you want. And it builds on progress from the last plan. So why don't we take the analysis piece first? Should I go back to here? Would that help you? If I can go back. Okay, there we are. Do you want to talk about the analysis you did to help us come up with the 50%, Peter? Here you go.
So it's not rocket science. We looked at the trends, and we also looked at the students who potentially can graduate. And we discovered that after our recent spike in graduation that got us to 20.6, that's the highest increase in CUNY in this for this past year, we noticed that we can continue this trend. And if we really put our hearts and minds to it, we can achieve 50% graduation rate for the incoming 2019 cohort. So remember, we're talking about students here graduating in 2022 who aren't here yet. So do it incrementally. But our projections indicate that for the current 2014 cohort, students who started in 2014 who are about to graduate in 16-17, we can be close to 30% if we get all of them, all of the ones that we identified as potential for graduation, if we get them to graduate. We've worked with the provost office, we've prepared lists for the advisors have the list, so it's already in the works. And we're currently working on the next cohort, which gives us even more chance to prepare because we're talking about students who just started in fall 2015. So with every single cohort, we have more knowledge and we have more experience how to get those students up to 50%.
Great, thank you. So as Peter said, there was some thinking behind this. It's not just a number that was pulled out of the air. And then something we talked about at the spring president's retreat, where divisions across the college meet and talk about where the college should focus for the next year as part of the strategic planning process. One of the big things that everybody talked about at that spring meeting, and in other meetings that I've actually helped facilitate on campus, I facilitated the continuing education workforce development retreat this spring. So we talked about how the last strategic plan probably had something to do with helping with that spike, because a lot of things happened at the same time, and because it is a really interesting phenomenon that. Of course, it won't click back now. That if you look at when the plan started, I mean, basically you have a flat rate, right? You have a pretty flat rate from 07, 08 to about 12, 13, and then something happens. That's pretty dramatic. So we said, interesting. Maybe that had something to do with what has been happening. So it's not like the expectation is we're going to get to 50% by, you know, starting from scratch. There's a lot of momentum from things that are already underway from that last plan. So in addition to it being aspirational but doable, we talked about how it's the right thing to do. And there's a lot of national data that suggests it. I mean, the first one isn't national data. It's what you all know, that students who come to a place like OSTOS come here to do something, to complete something. It may be a course. It might be a degree, but they come here to finish something. Did my mic just go off? No, it's on. Okay, and then the other components are the national data. So the last three are American Association of Community Colleges stats. There's a lifetime difference in earnings between college and no college of about $1 million for people. So if you think about that for a second, that's a pretty significant impact that you have on people's lives by having them complete an associate degree. There's also some stats around added tax revenue and taxpayer savings by people going to college. It's pretty straightforward. If you make more money, you go to a community college, you get a degree, you get a more better paying job, you contribute more to the tax base of this country, and it's in the billions, as you can see, as are the savings from students who experience, because they have a college degree, they find that correlates to better health and lower crime rates in their communities and reduced utilization on safety net services. So it has a pretty significant impact on the communities that we care about and the people that we care about. This is the president's thing that he has talked about a lot, and for me, it has really hit home, and it's one of the reasons I love working with community colleges is I get to really see how it impacts people's lives. I get to, most of my clients are foundations and, you know, people in suits, but when I come here, I get to walk through the halls and see students who are going to college and changing their lives. So, and I often think about this, and he talks about it, how a 50% completion rate is about doing what we would want for our families. And what he says is, would I send my kid to a community college or a college that has a 20% completion rate? Or would I send them to a place, do I want something more aspirational for my child, for my niece or nephew or my mother? You know? So I think that's why you see it as an aspirational jump from the 20%. So we're not going to, this is not where we're going to stop the conversation, but I want to take a pause because we just threw a lot of things at you. And I wanted to see if you have any questions at this point. Questions, concerns, anything to talk about? And when we're off camera at the end, you can come back to this. Okay. Great. Okay. So, since the focus is on completion, I wanted to warm us up for a second. Y'all know me. I like to do a little warm-up before we get into it, right? This is not going to be a crazy thing. I'm not going to make you do any skits for those of you that are expecting that. Carlos is not going to come in as a congressman. That happened the last time. I think he had a forum like this. Sorry, Carlos, you can't. I'll kill you if you do. No, I won't kill you. But what I'd like you to do is turn to your neighbor and have a conversation about this. Just turn to the person next to you, left or right, and who helped you finish something that's important to you? And let me just model for a second. Because I was thinking about this on the way here, and it made me think of my Mrs. Harrington, seventh grade, who, when I walked into class, I was terrified. I had braces. I was really funny looking. And I remember, no, it makes me emotional now. I remember her stopping class before she started anything, and she said, I just want to say something. I grew up in a really small town, so we knew everybody, knew everybody's business. And she said, I just want to say that before we start, that everything's going to change this year. Kids are going to act weird. Some of your best friends can be mean to you. Like, she gave us this lecture about what happens in middle school. And, like, it changed my life. Because then when my best friend is being really mean to me, I didn't freak out and all that stuff. And it helped me complete. It helped me do my homework. Because otherwise, I would have been entirely focused on all the social dynamics and freaked out about it. So it helped me. And middle school, you know, is where you take off to then get into high school and go to a better college and all that stuff. So I really got a lot of momentum out of, you know, she didn't just do it one time, but that kind of encouragement that I got. So she helped me finish something. So I just share that as an example. You can be that personal, or you can talk about something, you know, today. So take a minute and share with your neighbor who helped you finish something that's important to you. okay? Okay, everybody, I want to make sure at this point that you make sure to switch the conversation soon so the other person's talking, in case you haven't. Okay, take about 30 more seconds. If you haven't switched, make sure you switch. All right, start to wrap it up. Start to wrap it up, please. Okay, let's wrap it up, guys. I love that you're talking about it. I love that you're talking about it, but we need to wrap it up. Okay. Okay, Okay. Do I have to do that? Thank you. All right. Does anyone want to share, something that you heard in the conversation that you found was really interesting? Like, did we all remember the names of the people? Yes, I bet, right? Anyone want to share anything else that you thought was really interesting, maybe about what was shared to you or something that came up for you as part of it? Come on, help. Yes. Oh, yes, I love it. She's going for it. Here we go.
Hello, everyone. My name is Cynthia Jimenez. I'm a part of the SGA Student Government Association. I'm the Budget and Finance Commissioner. For that question, who helped me finish something that is important to you? I would say, actually, it will be myself, pushing myself forward. Getting to finish, high school, but now I'm pushing myself to finish for college. And I will also want to thank my parents, because they're also a great support. But when it comes to who helped you finish, it will be myself.
That's great.
Just talking to myself, just saying that you could do it. I know that there's some other students that are actually having trouble getting that help or that guidance. Mm-hmm. But that's why I joined SGA, to actually motivate other students to finding answers to their questions, knocking on doors, just actually finding the answer that they want and that they want to hold on to until they graduate.
Great. Thank you so much. Thank you for sharing. That was beautiful. So I heard a lot of things in there, and that's a great answer. That's a great answer. Yourself. I mean, and helping students understand how they have to help themselves is really important, right? I mean, that's something we've talked about, right? And you talked a lot about also that, the positive inspiration and reinforcement from key people in your life, like your parents. So anyone else want to share anything else that came up for you in that? Yeah, sure. Here, I'll bring it over to you.
Hello, my name is Jen Rosa. I'm a student, but I liked when this question came up because it made me think of all the things that I haven't finished and realized from the moment that I started at Hostos how badly it made me want to get into things that I wanted to complete. And thankfully, because of a lot of the programs here and a lot of the advisors and people that I've met, professors, they've actually helped me realize how important I am and my talents. And it's pushing me to be able to complete that. And no matter how many of the terrible things I go through, they're keeping me motivated. And it's actually kept me here this long to continue school. So I'm just thankful.
Thank you so much. That was beautiful. All right. Thank you. Wonderful, wonderful. Wonderful words that are inspirational to us all, but also a testament to your great work of those in the room. So one more question. Just on this in this vein, I know it feels kind of crazy, but who have you helped finish something? We want to flip the tables and have you to spend just a minute thinking about this question. I'm not going to model because you heard my other example, but the only thing I will say is I'm looking at Isabel right now, and Isabel and I helped a student together. And Isabel, I'll tell you about it afterwards, but it's a student that was struggling in a four-year college, basically couldn't handle the being away from his family emotionally, and got him into ASAP here at Hostos. And I just heard from his mom, he has a 4.0 average. So, yep, Justin. Anyway, so Cher, who have you helped finish something? For a minute. Turn to your neighbor, please. Neighbor, same neighbor, who do you want? All right, I'm going to keep this one more brief, so make sure you turn to the other person and get their point of view. Okay, you guys, about 30 more seconds. All right. All right. So I hear I have a great example in Esther nominated somebody. Allison. I lost my mic. Where did I put it? This is. Oh, here it is. Right next to me. Can you share your example? Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I didn't know you were here. So the person that I helped is the person that helped me. So during my time at Brook, I was in the master's program for higher education, and this person and I made a commitment to each other to meet every Sunday during the semester at the computer lab, and we would just make sure that we got through the day and got through all of our homeworks, all of our projects. If we needed to go outside to eat because we were in the computer lab too long, one of us would watch the other person's stuff. And it was really great because we held each other accountable and we were able to get through it together. It was probably like what made my master's program that memorable.
So, wonderful. Thank you for sharing. Does anyone else want to share an example that they heard? Going once, going twice? Yes. How can I resist that?
So, I'm going to speak briefly about the forgotten folks. I'm very happy about all those people, students that are at risk, whether it's because of disciplinary issues, whether it's because they don't know where to get their next meal from, whether it is because they, you know, didn't get their financial aid, etc. I'm happy that those students are still being retained and are graduating, even if it takes them a little bit more time. Thanks not to me, but to all of you for coming up with that money, coming up with that food voucher, and for just basically being there as a voice of reason during the most difficult times of their life, or even if it's just to listen and then refer them to someone else. So thank you all.
Oh, that's so sweet. All right, so we got the great examples of really how it's not about one person, basically. Both examples are, it takes a village is what I heard. So now what we're gonna do is we're actually gonna talk about the strategic plan. And what we want you to do is, what I'd like to do is consolidate a couple tables, if we can. If you guys can come over here or fill in the other tables. So we'll have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 tables here. And then I'd like to have, 1, 2, 3, 4, if we can have 5 tables here, if it's possible for the 4 of you to join another table. What we want you to talk about is, what do you think are OSTIS's current strengths and challenges related to student completion? And based on that, from your group, what would you recommend as the 3 to 5 major activities for the college to prioritize for the next 5? So we want you to do that. Now here's the process I want you to use. We don't have a ton of time, and the report outs can't be 10 minutes a piece or we'll be here until tomorrow. So what I want you to do is I want to have somebody responsible for kind of capturing the strengths and challenges and the 3 to 5. I want to have somebody else or that same person make sure that everybody at your table who wants to talk has the opportunity to get their voice into the conversation. Okay? And then we're going to take 15 minutes for that. Okay? We don't have a ton of time, but I bet you come with some ideas, right? You're not coming as a blank slate. So pick somebody quickly who's going to take notes and kind of make sure that everybody gets their voices into the conversation, and then go. I'll hear back from you in about 20 of. The questions are up here for those of you. You will each have 1 minute to report out. 1 minute. Trying to articulate between the continuing ed and the degree side, as well as remediation. So those have been the big areas of focus. So that's where most of the analysis has been. Yes, Peter. Are you sure?
Can I ask a follow-up question? Where are the income pressures?
Hold on. 1 second. Where are the incoming freshmen coming from? That's the question.
There's been no significant difference over the past 5 or 6 years. The proportion of students coming from the boroughs is the same type of high schools as well.
So it seems like it's been related to strategies as opposed to a difference in the population, is what you're saying, is I'm hearing. Okay, let's take two more questions and then let's do our report out. Are there any more questions? All right. Sounds great. Okay, so as I said, I'm going to try to do as fair and equitable a reporting out as possible. I'm going to set my timer for 1 minute for each of you. When it goes off, know that you're on fumes to finish. As I said, give me your notes from your group, and we'll include anything that maybe you didn't say, if you're willing to share your notes. And then if something is burning in your brain that you come up with tonight at 3 o'clock in the morning, you know, send it to the website and keep talking to us as we do this planning process. Okay, so which group would like to go first? I'm gonna pick. You wanna go first over here? You looked at me, unfortunately. Okay, wait, let me give you the mic. You keep following me around, I keep forgetting the mic. She's so good to me. And here we go, ready? Are you ready?
Go. What do you think are HCC's current strengths and challenges related to student completion? Let's see. Strengths. We have better support services since 2009. Special programs. We do a better job screening students. We do a better job assessing skills deficits. We do a better job with advisement. We are more proactive in terms of sharing information. What do students need? We also have faculty and staff that have increased awareness of programs and services, so they're better able to connect students with appropriate services and better assess student issues. We also have retention of staff, which provides for continuity, even though we know that we have some turnover, but at the end of the day, a lot of you are still here, right? So we also do a better job communicating that we still believe in our students and their ability to succeed. So we have a better understanding of our student population. We've expanded programs. Students are also more independent and able to do things on their own. Like, for example, with the whole big shift in registration, we no longer have to be here till 1 a.m., right?
So, Joanna, you're now on fumes officially. Sorry. It's past a minute. Okay. No. Keep, just say that your priorities then. We've got a lot of strengths and things like that. So what are the priorities?
Priorities. Increase cooperation. Perhaps reintegrate a first-year study program for students, not the New York State of Mind or SSD 100 courses, just a better first-year study program to determine and create, you know, I guess, better awareness. Yeah. And then do a better job with assessing college readiness.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing. Thank you for the mic. May I take your notes? Thank you. I'm going to go down the line and go back. The only reason I'm holding us to the 1 minute is math, because we have to leave by 5. Okay? So I'm trying to be respectful of your time. Carlos, I know you want this mic.
I had an unruly
I'm really
group.
Timing him. I'm that. Super timing him.
Anyway, so
go.
Many of the things that Joanna said, we also had. I'll just add a couple of quickie things on the strength, the operational planning, the success coach, and of course the advisement work, and our switching to reliance on data. Some of the challenges that we have is that we're very self-critical. And one of the other issues also with advisement, although it's a strength, we still need to do more work. So in terms of activities, continue the good advisement work that has been done up to now and expand on it, and come up with a mapping system that can tell students what all the services that are available in an easy way. And they're doing this in medicine, they're doing it, so we should be able to do it well here internally. And once we do that, to be able to do that,
Fumes.
I'll be done.
Fumes.
So create a mapping also for services outside and develop a peer mentoring approach to navigating college.
Thank you. That is, I think it was very generous of you. Usually Carlos, when he's given screen time, is not willing to consolidate. So was it that we didn't negotiate a union contract for you or something? Okay. All right. So next group. Here you go. Thank you. Time ready?
Yes.
Go.
Okay, we have for strengths. Plenty of wraparound services.
Oh. Is it on?
It's on. Yeah, plenty of wraparound services reside at the college. We have a family-oriented nomenclature here at the college, which helps students, you know, adapt to our environment being in college. Faculty and staff are very accessible to the students and to each other as well as staff. And the college is very affordable. You know, hopefully it'll be free in the future, because Governor Cuomo promises. Weaknesses, we have a lack of cohesion in processes and services. Some areas work in silos. There's somewhat of a low morale within some key stakeholders that students rely upon. Academic and non-academic space, there are constraints that may hinder our ability to expand and grow the way we need to. And communication, some feel that there's a lack of a communication plan to where there's a central repository of consistent, accurate information for students, faculty, and staff to rely upon. Activities. One is streamline as many business processes and workflow processes as possible. Create a centralized communication plan. Defragment the locations of service areas students rely upon. Consolidate the duplication of services around campus. Create a standard operations and procedures manual or website for services that we all can rely upon. Cross-functional orientation of student-based services so that we know what each other does. At least high level, and enhance the college website, make it more searchable and user-friendly.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And if you share with me your notes, that would be great. So I'm just going to pass it along so we keep moving. Hello. Here we go. And your timer is on.
Strength of our support services, for example, coaching unit, single-stop facilities, of course, public safety, tutoring, the diversity in our faculty, staff, and the life experiences that they bring to the table, the compassion of its community, the size of the college because it helps us maintain the special attention that we give our community, the pride that we take in our mission and the work that we do within the community, and our relationship with external organizations, challenges, fundraising, identifying new and ongoing donors to our funding raising efforts, preparation of our students not ready to begin college-level coursework, maintaining a uniqueness to our approach, staying true to our brand, making sure that we are not duplicating what other agencies or similar places are doing. Activities, polish, continue to improve and expand our college readiness programs with CBOs and other stakeholders to increase the success of the students entering college degree programs, identifying operating costs and improving efficiency, which can be reduced, and hopefully that funding can be shifted somewhere else to help our students succeed, and identifying programs which have produced the most graduates and the least graduates so that we can really see where we need to apply perhaps more resources.
Great. Wonderful. Thank you so much. All right, let's give a hand to the groups. I mean, we should give a hand to the groups. All right, you guys are up. You were the closest on time. I expect that from the chief.
Our strengths include our student support programs, because we have them in abundance.
Can everybody hear?
No. Our student support programs, these open dialogue discussions, I think, allow us to all get together, which is really nice. And the best thing about Hostos is that we care about our students, and it shows. We have a very nice approach when it comes to our students. In regards to challenges, we don't believe that we collaborate enough or clearly with other divisions. We simply work in silos. And how do we keep good employees were some of the questions we had regarding challenges. So activities we have come up with, streamlined support programs across the division so that we can meet once or twice a semester and share best practices to eliminate those silos, show value and appreciation of good employees and foster their growth, welcome orientation for all faculty and staff. An example would be a campus and divisional orientation and possibly a mentorship of 1 or 2 years for new faculty and staff so that they can stay here longer.
Great.
Increased customer service training for all faculty and staff. A mandatory orientation for incoming students so that they learn about all of the wonderful resources Hostos has to offer. And the last one is to make our website more user-friendly.
Great. Thank you so much. And she gave you a run for your money, Chief, on timing. All right, next group. I'm going to go over here just because of logistics, because I don't want to crawl through all that space. So who is reporting? Is that, who's over here? Over here. Great, thank you. Here, so, you ready?
Yes.
Okay, go.
So our current strengths and challenges are strengths. We have a variety of sources, resources, community partnerships, Success Coach, Single Stop, ASAP, and COPE. And these are different divisions that we have. Also, challenges that we face is lack of courses for certain students, outreach services for within communities within 10 miles of hostels, as far as outreaching students within the Westchester community, because hostel is closer in that location. Also, parking and that's what they put. I'm right now with
parking.
The 3 to 5 major activities is mandatory professional development on campus, more communication about major development projects within hostels as far as for staff members, as far as communication within that. And my time is up.
You can keep talking, but that's okay. Just letting you know
so
you're
on
fumes.
So I'm going to say one more thing.
Got to land the plane.
And a collaboration between continuing education and academic side as well.
Wonderful. Thank you. Give them a round. Thank you so much. And share with me your notes, please. Oh, just the... Okay, let's go over here. Who has the notes? Who's doing the notes? Is that you? Okay. Let Peter do it.
So we might repeat some of them. So the biggest challenges are socioeconomics, family-related issues, then, of course, finances, developmental ed, education, fragmented services, especially advisement, and we also noted down space issues. As far as resources, we have a lot of wraparound. We have a number of tutoring services, counseling, academic advisement. We have very dedicated faculty and staff. And for activities, we listed down as number one, a centralized advisement. Number two, early intervention area, identifying early intervention areas. And three, optimizing schedule and calendar to provide non-traditional access.
Wow, 40 seconds. That was fast. You get the gold star so far. Okay, could I have the notes, please? All right, it's not a race. What I love about what I'm hearing is it is helping us to remember what we already know is important, but it's also, there's some really great layers that we might not have had if you hadn't been here, so thank you for being here. I'm really hearing great stuff. Okay, you ready?
I'm ready.
All right.
Okay. I'm Elizabeth Wilson. I'm Director of School College Partnerships, and I'm getting us out of here before 5. I'm going right to the
there's one more
activities.
After you. Yes.
Okay. Strengths, ditto, challenges, ditto. So the activities are, number one, consistent advisement, which is already getting worked on, remediation, especially math, and getting people to take math, and customer service and communication.
Wow, record time. 20 seconds. All right, and share your notes. Please just pass them over to my pile, please. All right, last group. Here we go. Oh, wait, no, it's you guys. Oh, it's you guys, and there's two more, sorry.
I'm La La Landing my.
La La Land.
Singing the whole thing. No, strengths, committed staff and faculty, students.
This is Eileen, everybody.
Oh, right. Hi, I'm Eileen, Center for Bronx Nonprofits. Students are motivated to come here. They want to be here. The data that we have is stronger than ever. Challenges. Support services, simple things, metro cards, not so simple, housing, food. Two, we need to identify student needs pre-enrollment. We need to look at the schools they come out of to see what they're lacking in those schools. And we need to be matching the needs with services, even if it includes workshops and things of that sort, or giving them an incentive to come to orientation, but giving them part of a credit.
Great, thank you so much. All right, give a round. Okay, thank you for passing it off. Last group, no pressure. You have like 1 minute, literally.
Okay, the strengths are student programs such as ASAP and Student Success. The college is financially stable. Our buildings are in good shape. And we have a strong faculty and advisor team. The challenges, offering courses at an appropriate time so students can can graduate on time, the availability of having textbooks prior to a semester starting so students are ready to go when the semester starts. Sidebar question, what determines how schedules are made, the class schedules are made, and do we need participation or input from the students to try to make that schedule? Challenges, low response rate to student surveys, need more feedback from the students to improve their experiences, and supporting students through their socioeconomic barriers and challenges. Activities, expanding academic student supports to the weekends, an extensive orientation for re-entering students to acclimate them to school again, streamline the process of students obtaining supportive services, expanding opportunities for internships, and student outreach to improve student survey response rates.
Wonderful. Let's give them a round, and everybody, a round to you all. I'll have your notes if you wouldn't mind. That was wonderful. I'm not going to say anything other than thank you, thank you, thank you. If anything else comes up for you, please go to the website. If you don't know where to go, contact the president's office and they can tell you. It's anonymous. You can give feedback there anonymously. You can ask questions. Thank you for participating. We'll see you soon. Happy New Year.